Sing along. It's one of those things. It's been really important actually in my life, has been just reminding myself that no matter how I'm feeling, like physically or emotionally or spiritually, God always deserves the best that I can bring. Today my best isn't probably that great, even if our best isn't as good as like the person next to us or whatever it is. You know, we have, God deserves the best that we can give him. So let's do that here together this evening. Invite you to stand if you're able to, and let's begin to worship this evening. Thank you.
frozen like a stone that is breaking. In a state before a throne, and he shall reign forevermore, forevermore. He shall reign forevermore, forevermore. To us a child is born, King of kings and Lord of lords, and he shall reign forevermore, forevermore.
Before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit, and her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit.
John 3:16, Jesus tells us, for God so loved the world that he gave us his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life.
The fourth candle of Advent is the angel's candle. It is a symbol of love. This candle reminds us that the message proclaimed by the angels at Christmas is good news about a God who loves us. No matter who we are, no matter what we have done, we can each experience the love of God through a relationship with Jesus. Father, thank you for your infinite love. Thank you for so loving the world and for so loving your children, despite our individual shortcomings, despite our collective fall. Thank you for loving us so profoundly that you sent your only Son to live among us in our broken, dirty world to redeem us as a human sacrifice that we may experience your love for eternity. We ask that each of us would have the chance to feel wrapped up in your profound love during this season, that each of us would feel the peace, the joy, the hope, and the faith that your love inspires. Amen.
Desire of this.
It gets to that the idea of really of Advent, of waiting, of anticipating, of saying, God, we need you. We need you to do something for us and our brokenness. And so as we come here to the end, almost the end of Advent, this is the last one before Christmas. Can you believe Christmas is just in a few days? And so as we look towards Christmas, we also continue to anticipate. And what a great season to just stop and say, God, in all the craziness of everything that's happening around me, I look forward to celebrating your coming. And so so we're going to talk about that a little bit tonight. Let me ask you, have you ever longed for something that was lost? Have you ever, if you're like me, you've lost many things. but have you ever longed for something? Maybe you lost something that's important and longed for its return. This is Mary Grahams. And in 2004, she was doing some work in her yard. I think what they eventually figured out is that she lost her precious wedding ring in sort of their table scraps and stuff that got taken out into the garden to use as fertilizer and soil. And before she knew it, 2004, she finds herself, where's my precious wedding ring gone? She'd been married for many, many years by that point, and all of a sudden this precious thing to her, this sign that of her husband's love, was gone. She was actually so nervous about telling him that she didn't. she thought maybe it would show up. It didn't. And so she goes out and buys one that's kind of a knockoff similar one. And I guess he was a unobservant guy, because he never did notice. And he eventually passes away. And a few years later, she's on the same property. Her family has owned their property. She's in Alberta. And her same family has owned this property for like over 100 years, just passed it on down. And her granddaughter is out in the garden picking carrots for dinner and finds something and brings it in. Oh. And what she found was that she said, Grandma, you know, this farm has been in the family for years. Maybe you know what this is. This is 13 years later. This is 2017. She takes a look, and sure enough, it is her wedding ring. And so they cut it off of there, and she said, and it still fit. I love that story. At this point, her husband has been passed away for a few years, and yet in this most unexpected way, something precious to her, a symbol of love that had been lost, all of a sudden shows back up on the scene, and is a reminder of her husband's love for her. Something of great value is returned to her. And I think this is a good picture of Christmas. I think this is a great picture of Christmas. The human story at the beginning of the Bible starts with close communion with God. It says that God actually walked in the garden with people. This closeness, this relationship between humanity and God that is then severed by sin. And we've seen this in every one of our own relationships. How sin comes in and damages the relationship. Same thing
between us and God. Sin comes in, separates us. And the narrative of the Old Testament is of God moving towards restoration with his people, that relationship which has been lost. And he chooses a man named Abraham, decides to build a nation out of this guy's family, which would eventually lead to a kingship, the kingship of David. And prophets would eventually start speaking of a future king from the line of David that would bring peace and rule forever. And as you read through the books of 1st and 2nd Kings and Chronicles, and you start saying, all these kings, David sort of represents these glory days of this kingdom, and it just sort of goes downhill. And David himself was not perfect. And you see these kings, and there's this longing of all of these kings, as good as some of them may be, are still flawed because sin has damaged them the same as it has damaged us. And there became this longing of God, will this kingship ever have somebody who is not damaged by sin? Will there ever be somebody that we can serve and love and know and follow that is not damaged in the way that we are? And the prophets started speaking of this, and you get into all the books of the prophets in the Old Testament, and they start pointing towards one day there will be someone from this kingly line who will come, and he will be a perfect ruler, and he will rule forever. And then at the end of the Old Testament, the prophecies stop, and you've got a few hundred years of this silence of God. People long to be restored back into relationship with God. But when and how? And so you come to the end of the Old Testament, and won't tell you a ton about it right now, but I'm excited for a new teaching series we're going to do in the new year, where we're going to start at the beginning and say, what is the grand story? The whole, how does this, and so we're not going to walk through every single verse, but we're going to start at the beginning and say, let's go back to the beginning and let's walk through this whole narrative. And let's see how it all fits together. Because a lot of people, they know a verse or two here, or they pull a verse out here, but it's tough to know, how does this all fit together? What's the big picture? And so real excited about that. But you come to the end of the Old Testament, and then there's this silence. And then here's Matthew. Look at Matthew chapter 1. Now, sometimes these are the parts of the Gospels that we can skip, the genealogies, and we're just like, this is just a bunch of names. This is a family tree. Like why is this in here? This is boring. We're not going to go through the whole genealogy of what is in Matthew, but he starts by saying this is the genealogy of Jesus, and he traces it all the way through. But look at how he ends this genealogy. He says, so all the generations from Abraham to David, so from where God builds this nation of Israel, starting with Abraham to David, where we get this king, were 14 generations. Or you can think of it as two sets of seven generations. And from David to the deportation to Babylon, so when Jerusalem gets taken over and a bunch of them get deported off to Babylon, was 14 generations, two more sets of seven generations. And from the deportation to Babylon to the Christ, 14 generations. So from that time until Jesus, another 14, and then all of a sudden, Jesus hits the scene. We're fascinated by genealogies. And we're going to talk in a minute. Why does he go through the effort of saying there were 14 here, there were 14 here? Like, he just listed all of them. So for anyone who can count, it's like, yeah. But he makes an effort to say, well, there's this seven and seven group, then there's a seven and seven group, and then a seven and seven group, and then Jesus comes and becomes the seventh one. But we're fascinated by genealogies, right? I won't give away any spoilers, but Star Wars is all about, like, who's related to whom, right? And me and Sarah had this sort of ongoing debate, like, is this person related, you know, before this new one came out? But Star Wars is this story of saying, you know, hey, your father passes on this to the son, and then there's this sort of reckoning, how do we deal with all these things? And it's this idea of what is passed on to you, and then also what you choose to do and what you will pass on to others. There's a book I read recently called It's All Relative. This guy, I don't know if you've heard of A.J. Jacobs. He's not a Christian or a religious person, but he wrote a book called The Year of Living Biblically, where he decides to live out all the laws and the rules of the Old Testament, like literally for a whole year, and it's hilarious. And so he even like, he sees, oh, you know, someone commits adultery, they're to be stoned. And so he goes and he's in New York City, and hears somebody sort of talking about, you know, how they're cheating on their wife, and he gets a little pebble and tries to discreetly sort of throw it at him. And these hilarious things where he's like, how do I live out all this sort of Old Testament rules? Well, he decided to do another experiment when he said, you know, basically, everybody, if you go back far enough, everybody's related. Like, everybody's sort of tied together. And so he goes into this genealogy stuff and starts learning about this giant world family tree. And it's pretty laugh-out-loud funny, some of the stuff that that he discovers. But why is that so interesting to us? Well, because we're fascinated by genealogies. We're fascinated by, who did I come from? Who am I, you know, giving to the world? Like, what has been my family story? And for some of us, we're like, yeah, there's some great things in my family story. For some of us, we're like, man, there's some bad things in my family story. And I want to be the one that breaks that chain. Like, you know, maybe in your family, you're like, yeah, there were a lot of fathers who abandoned their kids. And I'm committing to break that chain. And I'm going to be the one who sticks it out. And, you know, or maybe you're like, man, things have been passed on to me, and a great heritage that I need to choose to embrace or to reject, or what am I going to do with it? But we're fascinated by genealogies. And I find it interesting that Matthew starts his book, begins this Christmas story with a genealogy. He takes us back to Abraham, then to David, then to Joseph, which puts Jesus in the prophesied kingly line of David. They're hoping for this king to come through the line of David. And Matthew's saying, look, if you trace all of this and you get to Joseph, Jesus' earthly father, then he becomes part of this kingly line. And the scholar N.T. Wright has some interesting perspective on this that I had never seen before. So in the Jewish customs, you have a Sabbath every 7 days, right? So they did it on Saturday. Oftentimes we today do it on Sundays. Sundays are so crazy for us. It's so much work for us for like most of the day that we try to take our Sabbath on Saturdays, where we take family time to rest and be rejuvenated and focus on each other, focus on God. And so, but you've got every 7 days, you've got this Sabbath where it says work for 6 days, and then on the seventh day, like, take time to rest. Build this into your life as a rhythm. And it's fascinating that even today, a largely non-Christian culture, non-Jewish culture, still practices a sort of this where there's businesses that are closed on Sundays. And it's not because they're necessarily practicing religious things, it's because this is built into us. That you can't just go 7 days, you know, 24/7 all the time. You'll destroy yourself. There's this wisdom to it. Well, then there's a sabbatical year taken off for the Jewish people. Every 7 years, there would be this sabbatical year. And we still oftentimes do this, right? A lot of times businesses say, on your seventh year, you know, we're going to give you some time off. You're going to get to go and like be rejuvenated for a longer period of time. And then in the Old Testament Jewish culture, there was something called the Year of Jubilee. So every seven cycles of sabbaticals. So like 7 times 7, right? So after all this time has passed, there would be something called the Year of Jubilee. And this is where debts were erased, slaves were freed. Like it was this time of everything being refreshed and saying, look, after all this time, like let's clear the slate. Let's all rest and forgive debts and give things back. And it was this amazing thing. So Matthew takes these generations. He groups them into groups of seven. He says there was these 7 generations, and there was these 7 generations. And after 6 groups of those 7 generations, Jesus is born. And in one sense, it's almost like he's saying, this is a person of Jubilee. So the same as the time, you know, this year of Jubilee where all these things would happen, he said, this person comes and he's going to represent us, and he's going to do things. He's going to heal people. He's going to bring forgiveness. He's going to do all of this stuff in a big way, representing all of this in a person as God himself comes to be among us. Because no king will ever be perfect unless God inserts himself into the timeline. right? He brings himself into that role. And so Christmas is the celebration of a king being born to establish God's kingdom on earth. And you look back at even that prayer that Jesus, when he was teaching his disciples how to pray, he says, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." It's saying, may God's heavenly kingdom be established here on earth. And may we live within this kingdom. And then he started teaching about what that looks like. Turn the other cheek. Forgive people who have wronged you. Like, don't just love your friends, love your enemy. This is what this kingdom looks like. And he starts teaching, what does life under this kingship look like? And then we get into this next part of Matthew. After all of that saying, like, so Matthew's, he's writing to a very Jewish audience. Matthew, more than any of the other Gospels, quotes the Old Testament. And so he's speaking to an audience that knew their Old Testament. And so he's bringing all these things from the Old Testament saying, look, this is who Jesus is. He fulfills this. He's this guy. This is the guy that you've been waiting for. And he says, now the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Now, to be engaged in that day essentially meant that you were married. You live just like you were married, except for some of the physical things that were a part of consummating your marriage at your wedding night, right? But for all intents and purposes, you were married. And so for Joseph to suddenly find out that his wife is pregnant, but they haven't come to their wedding yet, is essentially to find out that my wife has been unfaithful to me, the same as if somebody in a marriage had been unfaithful within that marriage. It says he finds this. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. Now the law of that day did not require him to divorce her quietly. Right? If he wanted to, he could have been very vindictive about this. Now, at this point, he doesn't know, right? He doesn't know that this is the Holy Spirit. And you can imagine if someone were to Mary were to tell him, no, don't worry, this is the Holy Spirit. I haven't been unfaithful to you, this Holy Spirit. He'd have been like, well, this has happened exactly 0 times in history. And so I'm going to say he's going to be a good, you know, he's going to go with David Hume. He's going to be like, it's better to go on the probability of you cheated on me than the probability of something that has never happened before has happened now. And so it's a good thing that the angel intervenes, because it says Joseph is a just man. Now, this is interesting. There's not a lot of great fatherly, husbandly role models in the Bible, right? The Bible's not trying to give us sort of this perfect fake version of people. The Bible tells us about people who they are, and you don't find many people that are, like, most of the people you find in the Bible are like, wow, they were just like us. They were flawed. Joseph's a great example. The law, according to the law, he could have made a big deal about this. He could have shamed her forever, right? He could have brought her before all these people, and he could have ruined her life. Now, many of us, that's our tendency, right? Someone hurts us, we lean towards, man, I need revenge, right? That's even our culture. If somebody, you see this on the internet, there's the internet age. If somebody says anything to you, it's like, shoot back twice as hard and blast back at these people. And yet Joseph says he was a just man. He didn't want to shame her. And so he was still going to divorce her, because as far as he knows, she's been unfaithful to him. And so he's still going to go through with these proceedings, but he's going to do it in such a way that can let her go off, most likely with her parents, to try and find some semblance of a normal life. And so he's doing something actually in her favor. But it says, as he considered these things, and I always love that, don't ever miss this part. We live in an age of immediate reaction. Like, something bad happens to us and we lash out right away. I love that Joseph, like the probably the most painful thing that could happen to someone, finding out that, you know, that your partner's been unfaithful to you. And it says he considered these things. He's not just going to react. He's not going to let his emotions get the best of him. He thinks it through. He says, what is in the best interest of everybody here? And I really like Joseph, because I think he's a great role model for us as men. says he considered these things. He's been deeply hurt, probably, before he knows the rest of the story, but he considers things. He doesn't just react. He doesn't let his emotions just push him to do something crazy. It says, as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David. Why does it say son of David? Because David's not his immediate father, right? It's saying, Joseph, in the line of David, like you're part of this kingly line, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. Is saying this problem that has plagued everybody since the beginning of time, he's come to fix that problem. He will save them. And all this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin, he's quoting Isaiah here, behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel. And that word Emmanuel means God with us. In the ancient world, that is unheard of. Gods were not with you. Like, gods were out there. And you sacrificed many, I mean, in the Old Testament times, there are all these other nations, they would even sacrifice their own children just to try and say, if I can give enough, if I can sacrifice enough for this God, then maybe they'll send the rains and we won't all starve to death because we'll have a good crop season. Like, that was the extent of the relationship, right? Is what can we do to try and earn this God's favor? It says, they will call his name Emmanuel, God with us, God coming to be among them. And when Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had given birth to a son. And he does exactly what the angel told him to do. He called his name Jesus. Tonight we lit the angel's candle. It's tempting today sometimes, and especially at Christmas time, to focus too much on angels and not enough on the angel's message, right? And I've talked to a lot of people who they don't believe like any stuff in the Bible. They don't really believe Jesus. They don't really believe in any of that, but they believe in angels. And I'm not necessarily sure why, because if angels exist, if angels are some sort of other thing that's different than like the material world or whatever, some sort of spiritual thing, then that, in my mind, brings up the question, so like, where did they come from? Like, what do they do? Who are they? Are they just things on Christmas cards? And you're just like, oh yeah, the angels, right? And remember, we talked about this last week. Every time an angel shows up in the Bible, the first thing they always have to say is, fear not. Because it's not like, oh, an angel in like flowing white robes, strumming a harp, floating on a cloud. Like, the reaction is usually like, ah! And when people start worshiping, often they start worshiping like the angel. Or they're in fear of the angel. And the angel's like, you know, no, do not fear. But essentially what an angel is, really what the word angel, angelos, means, is messenger. These angels are simply messengers. Now, they're powerful. They do some powerful things in the Bible, right? They're definitely not just sort of timid harp strumming, you know, but their role is to deliver a message from God. And so they are not the ones to be worshipped, right? They are the ones who are saying, we come with a message to you. And this angel intervenes in the life of Joseph before he does something that he would go on to regret. They're messengers for the king, but they aren't the king. And you can imagine in the days of kings, you would treat the king's messenger with respect because they bring a message from the king. But if you were in the presence of the king, you're not going to get those two confused, right? You're not going to be like, oh, you were the one who brought the message to us on horseback, but you're the one who rules the country. like, you know, you're there's not going to be that confusion. Same thing with angels. They bring them the message. Son of David is a reminder that Joseph comes from this kingly line. It says, that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit, which basically is saying God is at work and he has stepped into history in a way that he hasn't done before. He is entering history right into the kingly line of David. The problem that has separated people from God, this problem of sin, will be addressed once and for all. And so let me just say one quick thing. This is kind of for theology nerds. And so I don't want to lose you on this. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time here, but it's fascinating to me. the virgin birth is sometimes something that can trip people up, like why? Or, you know, that hasn't happened before. And, I mean, yeah, it's a miracle. And sometimes critics of the Christmas story will say, well, there's all sorts of other gods in mythology and history that claimed to be virgin birthed. And really, it's, you know, virgin birth is not a great term. Really, it's virgin conception. But, birth is sort of its own thing, right? But, so like Alexander the Great and all these other, you know, a lot of these Greek gods and these things, the stories around them were like, yes, they were born of a virgin as well. And sometimes you'll see, like on Facebook, you'll see these memes that come every now and then, and it tries to compare these people. Oh yeah, this guy, virgin, claimed to be born of a virgin. Or, you know, all these sort of kings oftentimes would claim this. But if you look at things at a surface level, then you'll always see them just at a surface level, right? But if you dig a little bit deeper, and it doesn't take much digging in many of these cases, you realize a lot of these guys that claim to be virgin, you know, virginally concepted or whatever, is really, really not the same thing at all. Often, and we won't get into details because got young ears in the room, but oftentimes what would happen was one of these Greek gods, one of these gods would like force themselves on some human person and give birth to like a half god, half human, like Hercules, right? So many of these stories, it's not this idea of she's conceiving by the Holy Spirit, sort of the Holy Spirit will overshadow her. You know, she's being let know what's going to happen. If you go to Luke, you hear Mary's version of this story, right? How the angel comes and tells her this is what's going to happen. If you look to a lot of these other stories, that's not what happens. It's typically like Zeus will disguise himself as a person, come down, sort of do his thing to some poor human woman, and then the result will be some half god, half person. And so when you see those memes floating across Facebook, don't just take them at face value. Dig a little deeper, because what's being talked about here is very different than many of these other myths and other stories. So what's the significance of that, right? Why virgin conception? It's a significant Christian belief that has been held from the beginning. And it's significant because it bypasses the problem that plagued all other previous kings, which was this idea of sin. Now Christian theology teaches us, as we dig into what Paul teaches, and especially in Romans and some of these books, teaches this, and there's some mystery to it, but sin being passed on to each one of us, right? So no kid is born sinless, right? It doesn't take long to see it happen, to see it play out. This problem of sin being passed on from generation to generation. And so, born of Mary, born in the line of Joseph, makes him a king from David, but born from virgin conception of Mary bypasses this sin being passed on. It's saying this king, who would ultimately become a sacrifice, doesn't have the same issue that all the other kings had, because God puts himself directly into the story. And so Jesus is born sinless. Now this is getting deep into a lot of theology, but basically Jesus is fully human, but he's not merely human. And so what that means is he's got all the attributes that make him fully human, but he doesn't have this secondary attribute called sin. You don't have to have, sin is not a necessary component of being human, right? And so Jesus has all, because people will be like, well, was he really human? Was he fully human if he didn't have sin? So, well, sin is not required to be human, right? Humans started without it. And so Jesus has everything to make him fully human, but not the sin part of that to make him fallen, just like all the other kings. And as we read on, when we get to Easter and Jesus, we talk about Jesus' sacrifice, ultimately that plays a big role in that. He becomes this perfect sacrifice. And so it says, they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God is with us. So he's not just this moral teacher. He's not just sort of a good rabbi. It's saying, no, this guy, because of this virginal conception from God, will be God with us. This is unlike anything else that has come before and that has come since. And Jesus didn't come in the way that they expected. They were asking for an earthly king, Jesus will be a king to bring heaven to earth. And so I think there's an interesting parallel in the Lord of the Rings. So I'm kind of a Lord of the Rings nerd. Not as much of a Lord of the Rings nerd as I am a Star Wars nerd. But Tolkien, who wrote this, was a very, very strong Catholic believer. And so it wasn't like Chronicles of Narnia, where Lewis made those really to speak Christian messages. They were allegories. Lord of the Rings is not that, but you can see many Christian themes coming out in Lord of the Rings because Tolkien was so deeply religious, and he's actually the one who helped C.S. Lewis on his journey to eventually become a Christian himself. And so in the Lord of the Rings, you've got this guy. He shows up on the scene. He's dirty. He's greasy. He's living out in the wild. They call him Strider. They're like, who is this guy? And what you don't know at the time is that he's the king. He's this king that's going to come and sort of bring peace to Middle Earth. But it's not what anyone's expecting. People are missing it. I love the parallels to the Christmas story. And actually, in The Lord of the Rings, if you sort of get into the nerdy part of it, you learn that their journey actually starts on Christmas. And so he's sort of, and don't ask me how to figure it all out. I've gone to other nerdier people than me to figure this out. But their journey starts on Christmas. And they destroy the ring, so they do all that at Easter. And so it's this really cool parallel. But he shows up not looking like a king, sort of like a baby born in a manger. Right? By the way, if you didn't grab one of these, got our logo on the back, there's a basket. Please take one and put on your tree at the end of the service, or just at the back table. But you got a baby born in a manger, and you're like, this doesn't seem like a king. This doesn't seem like the way royalty would be brought into the world. It's unexpected. Well, then they got to go on this journey, right? He's got to go, and they've got to fight this big battle, and ultimately, Easter has to happen. Like, evil has to be defeated. And so they do. And that's kind of where the movies end. But actually, there's something interesting in the book. And a lot of people, when they read the Lord of the Rings books, they're like, this is sort of anticlimactic. Why is this in here? It's called the Battle for the Shire. So where all the hobbits are from. Basically, after this huge war is won, and Aragorn, you know, becomes the king, and there's all this stuff, they sort of have to go and clean up some messes. And they go back to the Shire, and they realize the Shire's been overrun with orcs, and they got to go back and continue the fight over there, and Saruman, who's sort of the big bad guy, he's not quite defeated yet, and so they got to go and fight him still. So this is where the books and the movies take off a little bit. And I think this is a great picture of the Christian story. Because you got Christmas, Jesus come to earth, the king is here. Then the king's got to do some stuff, and then you come to Easter, where evil is vanquished, and essentially the war is over. But things aren't perfect yet, right? There's still this sense of like there's some things to be worked out before everything is perfect. And I think that's where we're living right now. We're on the other side of Easter, but the story's not quite over yet, right? We're sort of in this part, right? It's like the battle for the Shire right now. And we're like, hey, there's still some things working out as this kingdom establishes here on earth. We've lit the candles of hope, peace, and joy. And all of these are results of the Christmas story. But what is the motivation behind the Christmas story? The results of Christmas are hope and peace and joy. What's the motivation? It's the candle we lit tonight, the candle of love. It is out of love that God sends Jesus to us. True love did not remain distant. It was not some God up in the clouds. It says God came to us, Emmanuel, God with us. And Christmas is about many things. But one of those things is about restoration, saying God himself came to us to fix what we could not fix, is a beautiful picture of love. And I remember my dad telling me a story of a guy that he met who was a worship leader. He led music at a church, and he was having some trouble with his son. Son had some rebellious time in his teenage years, and as he became a young adult, he was just really pushing against everything his dad was doing, and everything his dad stood for. Now it's hard for, his dad works at a church, he leads worship, for this big church, and yet his own son is rejecting the thing that his dad believes in. And he starts making these bad decisions, and he starts getting into things that are really starting to really starting to embarrass his father, and there's more and more tension that starts to grow in this relationship. And his son has the musical gene of his dad, and he's playing in a band, but he's playing in some scuzzy bars and some of these places where it's just like, his dad's like, man, if people knew where my son was hanging out, then like, how would that reflect on me? And we used to play in a band with my brother and some guys, and we played in some places where I was just like, Mom and Dad, you should probably come to the next show. You know, some of these, I mean, when the place is called the Underground, you're like, oh man. And so this guy's playing in these places, and his dad's just worried more and more, like, I'm losing my son. My son rejecting all of this. And as the tension grows, one day his son comes home and says, Dad, I've got some news to tell you. I've got my girlfriend pregnant. And that was the straw that broke the camel's back. And this dad finally just unleashes into his son. And he says, you know, what's wrong with you? Like, what are you doing? You're embarrassing us. And like, what's your problem? Like, and just rips into his son. And son storms off, and that relationship is just broken. Doesn't hear from him. The son and the girlfriend, they go off. Eventually they have this baby, and the relationship is severed. And then this pastor, he has a moment where God gets his attention, and where he learns about grace. And he learns, man, every Sunday I go and I lead music singing about the grace of God to my life, and yet I haven't shown grace to my own son. I've been more concerned about my reputation, about the things that I want, that I've sacrificed my relationship with my son. And so he just becomes broken, pulls over on the side of the road. He's just weeping, crying out to God, God, give me one more chance to make right with my son, to reach out to him. And so he finds out where his son's band is playing next. And he shows up, goes up there, and he gets there early. He finds a table as close as he can get to the stage. Now, this is the kind of place that this, you know, suit and tie pastor has never been in his life. And he walks in, and he's just sort of thinking, and he gets like a Diet Coke or something. He's like, I got to make it real obvious to anybody who might see me. And he goes and he sits in this table, and he's right there by the front of the stage. And his son walks out, band's about to play, and he stops and he sees his dad sitting right there in the front row and just kind of pauses for a minute, like, Dad, what are you doing here, kind of thing, and he composes himself, and they play their set, and his dad's sitting there front row by himself the whole time. And after the show, his son comes to him. I haven't seen each other in forever. He says, Dad, what are you doing here? Well, I came to hear your band. He says, Dad, you hate places like this. He says, Dad, you hate music like this. And his dad says, you're right about both of those things, but I love you, and so I want to be where you are. Every Sunday after that, son starts coming back to church, bringing this man's granddaughter and his girlfriend with him, and that relationship begins to be restored. Because when I see the story of Christmas, I see God saying, I love you. And although there's mess all around you, although there's brokenness all throughout your life, although you're doing things that I don't want you to do, I love you enough to enter into the mess. I love you enough to go where you are, Emmanuel, God with us, saying God doesn't stand back and observe as we just fall apart. It says, I loved you enough to enter into your world, to come to you. Guys, this is different than what any other religion teaches, any other philosophy teaches. The story of Christmas, Emmanuel, God with us. When we say, O come, Emmanuel, saying, God, we need your presence. We don't need knowledge of you. We don't need to just hear about you. We don't need to hear stories about you. God, we need your presence. That's what Christmas is about, is God showing up on the scene himself, coming to us, and entering into our mess. And so I'm going to invite Jake and Stephen back up, and they're going to lead us in a moment in another song. And in just a minute, I'm going to have James share from what he's been painting tonight. But let me ask us, what does this mean for us? It gives us a completely different picture of God than any other religion out there. It also shows us that Christmas is part of a much bigger historical story. There's more going on at Christmas than you ever see just on the surface. You see the Christmas cards, you see the ornaments, you see the nativity scene, and sometimes it's easy to forget. There's a lot of history that's leading up, that's pointing to this moment. That's what Advent gets at. It's saying, as we anticipate, as we look forward, each one of these candles is not the end of that story. And so each week we say, there's another piece of the puzzle that comes together, and on Christmas Eve, we'll light what is called the Christ candle, where it says, finally, all of these things, all of these generations, all of this history, you have this whole Old Testament representing hundreds and hundreds of years. You're like, all of this stuff, all of the brokenness, all of the kings that failed, like all of the priests that failed, all of the sacrifices that weren't enough, all of these people who longed for God to be among them. I said, we're worshiping in a temple, but it's not the same thing. God, we're sacrificing animals, but it doesn't take away our sin because we need a perfect sacrifice. God, we long for you. O come, Emmanuel. We need God to be with us. And as we look towards each week of Advent, we look towards Christmas, where that time finally is here. And so this Christmas season, I hope it's more to you than just lights. I love Christmas lights. We're going to drive around with family and go see them all, right? But it's more than that. It's more than the good baking. Now, don't get me wrong. Like, I'm going to put down some good bacon. But it's more than that, right? It's more than the gifts. Like, I love getting a gift as much as the next guy. Slightly less, more enjoyable to me is giving gifts, but I also like that. That's a good part of Christmas, right? The you know, the bells and the whistles and all that stuff. But there's some deep things going on in the Christmas story. And I hope I didn't lose you with some of it tonight. We dug deeper into some theology than oftentimes we go. But that's because I hope, even if you're like, some of that I can't really make sense of, that we need a lot longer to make sense of that, I hope at least you take some of that and realize there's a whole lot more going on at Christmas than what I see when I go to the mall. Christmas is a huge deal where God came to be with us. And so how should that impact the way we see ourselves? Do you grasp the love of God, that he loved you so much, that he entered into your world instead of asking you to try and climb your way into his world? How does this affect the way we see other people this Christmas season? I'll be honest, even driving around the other day, I got super frustrated with somebody. It wasn't even their fault. I didn't realize I was at a four-way stop going into a parking lot, and you know, honks were exchanged. and I'm just being real. I was thinking, like, man, like, what am I doing? Like, why am I letting things like that get? Am I seeing people the way God sees people? It's like, that guy that honked at me, God loved him enough to enter into his mess, the same as he loved me enough to enter into mine. And so how does that change the way I see people, and how does that change the way I treat people? God has established his kingdom here, and may our lives be reflections to other people of what that kingdom looks like. People are like, what's it like to be a Christian? Like, what does that look like lived out in real life? What does this kingdom look like? May they look at us and say, wow, like, you guys aren't perfect, but you love people. You show grace. You're moving forward. You're trying to be more like Jesus as God changes us from the inside to reflect the King who loves us. At Christmas, we celebrate Emmanuel, God with us, and that changes everything. And so I'm going to invite James. James, if you want to share, then it's great to have some of this put into a visual. And so why don't you share with us tonight?
Sure.
What you think?
I painted at the service this morning, and it had a similar feel to what I felt your message was. And so I wanted to try to recreate a little bit of what I was trying to do this morning. I didn't have a lot of time this morning because of just the way the service went. Plus, it was dark, so I could hardly see. And I thought, maybe I'll try this painting again, but maybe try to make it a little more realistic. And so I'm going to share with you the elements in the painting here. So you have God who became flesh and took on the form of a baby, lying in the manger here, and I have Joseph here who's holding Mary, and like you were saying, Mike. Joseph's an amazing example of grace,
yeah.
And so, but it all turned out so amazing because Jesus was the Messiah. Imagine being the father of the Messiah, or at least the father who got to take care of the Messiah, and Mary the mother of the one who was the hope of Israel and the hope of the nations. And I wanted to have a scene where there were the shepherds kind of coming down from the hill, and amongst the shepherds, this is also big because I didn't quite get to it just like this morning, but I wanted to have kings in with the shepherds, because the kings who were the exalted of society, they're really equal with the shepherds who were more on the bottom end of society. But they had to come, both of them, come and bow before the Christ. And with the painting I had this morning, I also had the wood from the manger becoming the cross. And Jesus in the crucifixion on the bottom here, just to show where that was going to go, where redemption was going to come, and that he offered himself as a sacrifice for our sins. He made himself nothing and took on the very nature of a servant, humbled himself even to death on the cross. And so he didn't stay a baby, but he became the man who was the sacrifice for all of humanity. Took down that dividing wall of hostility between the Jew and the Gentile so that salvation could go to the entire world.
That's awesome. Thank you, James. Well, why don't we, this is the last Sunday of Advent. And so why don't we take a few moments here and sing together. We're going to sing about this love coming down to us. And so would you stand? Let me pray for us, and then we're going to sing. And then after we sing, I'm going to invite my wife, Sarah, up to let us know a few things that are coming up in the next month or so. Let us pray and then sing about this love together. God, we thank you. We thank you that... You loved us so much that you came to enter into our brokenness. And so, God, I pray tonight that if we've forgotten that, if we don't feel loved, if Christmas is a hard season for us, or maybe we just need to be reminded again that love came down. And even if we don't feel loved by anybody else this season, at least not perfectly, would we know that you displayed your love in an act of such great sacrifice that, Lord, you connected us back in relationship with you. And so would we focus on that this Christmas season? Would we enjoy all the other things that there are? But this season, God, would we remember that you loved us and that you would restore that relationship with anyone who would accept that sacrifice. And so, God, we thank you. And even now as we sing, would this just be an expression of our gratitude for what you have already done? And so, God, we worship you now in Jesus' name. Thank you.
guys can have a seat. Try not to keep you much longer. Just a couple things. First, thank you for being here tonight. If this is your first time, you'll find out on your seat some envelopes. And if you just fill that out with your information and bring it up here to Mike, we'd like to exchange that just to greet you or to meet you and to exchange it for a small gift. Just to say thanks for being with us and we'd love to connect with you. You can also use those envelopes if God is leading you to worship Him through offering tonight. You can put your offering in there and drop it in the box at the back of the table. Also, if you want to be part of our e-news, I'm going to share just a couple dates with you. So if you are like, oh, I've written it down, there's so much info, and we send out a weekly email with those dates and that information and more details. So if you're not receiving that and you want to be receiving that, you can use that envelope as well to put your contact information. Just make sure you check on there, I want to be added to the e-news. Just love to stay connected with you in that way. So speaking of fun things coming up, Christmas Eve service is on Christmas Eve. I believe it's Tuesday night. So last year I was home for my first full day with my newborn on Christmas Eve. And I had some very generous people take care of my boys, my two older boys, at the Christmas Eve service because Mike was playing drums. So I was going to be home by myself with all three. With a three-day-old. So they generously took them, and I loved it. I was so grateful, but the Christmas Eve service is one of my favorite services to rejoice with church family of the whole year. And so I was grateful for the time alone, but I was a little bit lonely. I was a little bit sad that I wasn't with my own family and I wasn't with my church family. So super excited to participate in the Christmas Eve service. There's two times. There's a 4:00 and a 6:00, and these will be at the Westin on Bear Mountain. So we'd love to see you there, and just again to worship the coming King, and just remember what God did during this for this season. So that's Christmas Eve, and then also we're participating in Alpha. I'm sort of learning about Alpha. I think it's you guys sort of know, but it's a meeting of college students. It's a place to explore Christian faith with others, and so we have the opportunity as we partner with the organization that's leading this to provide a meal for those who are attending. It's Wednesday nights starting Wednesday, January 15th. So if you are willing and able to help provide a meal for one of those Wednesday nights, there's a sign-up sheet at the back table. There's already a couple people signed up. I know we'll be providing a meal, and it's just one of those great parts of Alpha where you get to sit and discuss over a meal. There's just something that we need about connecting with people while you're eating. How many people are we providing food for?
We don't know yet.
And so, people are still signing up, so we're not really sure.
So
if you're willing to provide a meal but funds are maybe a little bit tight or getting to the grocery store is hard, please let us know if we could help you provide that meal in that way, or pick it up, or deliver it, or any if you're like, oh, I'd love to, but come talk to me about the but part, and I will help you figure that out so that you can participate in this great thing. There's also an Alpha group starting for ages 38 to 72 here in the Oak Bay area. So if you're interested in participating in Alpha and those discussions and just diving deeper in your faith, there's a sign-up sheet at the back table for that as well. I just want to say a big thank you to our children and families for participating in Advent with us by creating these beautiful ornaments. I'm just overwhelmed that you have chosen to bring your family to worship with us. And I'm every week I just think, like, I'm so thankful to the Lord that just in a small way, I can be a part of your children's foundation of their faith journey. And so just thank you so much for bringing your children and having them participate. We'd like you to take your ornaments home tonight and hang them on your tree. Don't forget to grab those off of our tree and take those home. Hopefully you wrote your name. And just remember the subjects or topics of Advent that we talked about over the last few weeks as you're home this week celebrating the birth of Jesus. So that's it. You guys are, you know, anything else? I prayed before, so I got confused. Anyway, all right, so thank you. Hopefully see you Tuesday night. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Yeah.
Savior.